Well, welcome back. A very good morning to you if you're joining us at Southborough Lane Baptist Church online. If this is your first time, you are so welcome. If you've been with us for a little while, you are also so welcome. We are going through this little punchy series, Road to Recovery, looking at 8 key steps to help us to recover from our hurts, our habits, and our hang-ups. And today we are coming to step 6. Now, if you've missed the first 5 steps, they're available online. So why not catch up and join us on the road to recovery? Today is step 6, but I'm going to split it into 2 parts. So step 6, part 1 today, and then step 6, part 2 next week. And part 1 is going to look at how important on the road to recovery it is that we forgive those who have hurt us. And then the second part of this 6th step that we'll look at next week is the need to make amends with those that we have hurt. So 2 parts to a very important step. So we're looking at step 6 today. Let's get underway.
I hear the sound of awakening. The sound of lives changing. The sound of second chances. I hear the sound of men and women who were once dead but are now alive. Graves opened, hearts beating, lungs breathing. It's the sound of the future. A future of joy, a future of faith, a future defined not by what we've done, but by who we're becoming. A future where freedom is found and debts are forgiven, where families are healed and hope is restored, where no one is too far gone and nothing is impossible. It's the sound of recovery. It's the sound of celebration and joy.
Well, welcome to step 6 of Road to Recovery. Now, here's a quick review. First step was, realize I'm not God. I admit that I am powerless to control my tendency to do the wrong thing and that my life is unmanageable. Step 2 was, earnestly believe that God exists, that I matter to him, and that he has the power to help me recover. Step 3, consciously choose to commit all my life and will to Christ's care and control. Step 4, openly examine and confess my faults to myself, to God, and to someone I trust. Step 5 was voluntarily submit to any and all changes God wants to make in my life and humbly ask him to remove my character defects. That was step 5. Now we come to step 6, which in its entirety is evaluate all my relationships, offer forgiveness to those who have hurt me, and make amends for harm I've done to others when possible, except when to do so would harm them or others. And that is step 6 in its entirety. But we're going to look at step 6 in the 2 parts I mentioned earlier. So part 1, offering forgiveness to those who have hurt us. We're going to do that this week. And then part 2, making amends for any harm we've done to others. We'll do that next week. Offering forgiveness. Gosh, it's a difficult subject. Reminds me of the occasion when an ex-boxer had trouble with 2 men. He'd become a Christian and they didn't like it and they hit him. And he did the Christian thing. He turned the other cheek as per Jesus's instruction. So they hit him again. And then he said to them, "The Lord has given me no further instructions. So take this." And he knocked them both out. And, you know, I think when we hear stories like that, and when we hear stories of people getting, as it were, justice and revenge, we often feel that when it comes to forgiveness, that's the way it should be. It's hard to extend forgiveness to those who have done us wrong. It's difficult, and it doesn't feel fair. In fact, as a general rule, That's how we all view mercy and justice. We all want justice when it comes to our enemies, but when it comes to us, we want mercy. But God wants us to understand that if we want to find complete healing in life from our hurts, there is no room for unforgiveness in our lives. You know, it can be a very difficult teaching to embrace and to follow. So let's have a little look at why that is. Why should we forgive? Well, first of all, because God has forgiven us. Look at what the Bible has to say. It's there in Ephesians chapter 4. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Another reason, because resentment doesn't work. To harbour resentment and unforgiveness is like us drinking poison and expecting it to kill the other person whom we're resentful about. It doesn't work. And here's another reason, because we will all need forgiveness in the future. Remember the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And then it goes on a little later to say, forgive us our trespasses, as we also forgive those who trespass against us. God says it's so important. So how do we forgive? Well, first of all, reveal your hurt. When you're hurting, you can repress it, you can pretend it doesn't exist, but you can't get over your hurt until you admit the pain. We have to admit, they hurt me, it was wrong, and it really did hurt me. But once we admit the hurt, then we're in a much better position to forgive that person. Look, you can't forgive a hurt that you're not admitting to having. Second thing, we release the offender. You know, the second step in forgiving an offender is releasing them. How does that work? Well, don't wait for the offender, the person who's hurt you, to ask for forgiveness, because they may never do so. You have to make the choice to do it independently of whatever the other person's attitude is. You do it whether or not the other person asks for forgiveness or whether they don't. Why? Because you're doing it for your sake, not for the other person's sake. You do it for three reasons that we should really take to heart. First of all, God has forgiven us, resentment doesn't work, and we will need forgiveness ourselves in the future. And remember, forgiveness is not a one-off thing. Those feelings of resentment are going to keep coming back. Every time they do, we must forgive again until we have fully released the person who has hurt us. Now, I know the question that you're asking, and I've asked it too. How will I know if I fully released the person who hurt me? Well, we'll know when we can think of them and it doesn't hurt anymore. We'll know when we can pray for God's blessing on that person's life rather than praying that God would strike them down. You know, when we can begin to look at and understand the hurt that they probably feel rather than focusing on how we have been hurt by them, because we need to remember that hurt people hurt people. They've hurt us because they're hurting. And when we can understand they're hurting, we're releasing them. And we keep forgiving until the thoughts of that person or the offence they committed aren't associated any longer with the hurt we feel. Now, we may not be able to completely forget, but we can release the offender and we can let go of the pain, and that is good for us and our own recovery. Is it always wise to release the offender face to face? No, not always, because to bring up old hurts may not be productive for us, and it may not be very kind for them or to them. If our parents hurt you, they may not even know about it. And for us to go back to them and, you know, perhaps 40 years later and bring up old pain might just destroy them. So also, you know, we might not be able to find some of the other people, even if we wanted to. They may have remarried, they may have moved away, they may even have died. So what do we do when it's impossible to actually do this releasing of the offender face to face? Well, there's two techniques we can use. First of all, there's the empty chair technique. We sit alone with an empty chair and we imagine the person that we need to forgive sitting in that chair. And then we can say to them, I need to say some things to you. Here is how you hurt me. And then we can lay it out and say, you hurt me, but I want you to know that I forgive you because God has forgiven me. I am releasing you. And it really helps to give voice to it. Another way, it's very similar, is a letter or an email that we will never send. In the letter, we put down in black and white how we have been hurt. And we say, having laid it out, we say, but starting today, I forgive you because God has forgiven me. And we do this for our own sake. We release the person who has hurt us and that we are forgiving so that we can experience freedom. Next thing, we need to replace our hurt with God's peace. At some point, all this forgiveness is going to start to feel very unfair. And we're going to say, well, you know, if I forgive this person, especially if I have to forgive them without them asking for forgiveness or without them, you know, without me ever confronting them face to face, then essentially they get off scot-free, don't they? And I've been hurt and they have suffered no consequences. And that's just not fair. Well, it's at that point that we need to learn to relax, to trust God to handle the consequences. When we learn to release the people that have hurt us, and when we learn to allow God to be in charge of ultimately setting the score straight, we will discover the wonderful blessings of His peace. And that is part one of this important step six, forgiving others. Next week, we are going to think about making amends with those that we have hurt. But now let's just reflect, listen to the words of this song, and allow God to speak to us about those He would love us to forgive, those He would love us to release. Father, we have looked today at the vital need to forgive those who have hurt us, because we want to be forgiven by you, and you ask us to forgive others. But also we know that to hang on to unforgiveness and resentment actually just keeps us prisoners. So help us by your power and by your goodness and your grace, help us to forgive those that we need to forgive. We ask it in the name of Christ. Amen. Thank you so much for joining today. I really hope to see you next week for the second part of Step 6. Until then, stay safe and God bless you.